work world? Are they dependable? You know what? It's not by your schedule. It's by somebody else's schedule. Can they get along with others? I was very outspoken in college. Are they willing to adapt? You're going to have to do things you don't want to do. My first job when I got to the United States, I'm from Canada, when I was in college, I worked at a McDonald's for a few months, which I hated. My father would not let me quit it, even though I didn't really have to have the job. He said to have the job to pay for fun things, like putting gas in my car or doing things. I could not leave that job until I found another job. So what did I do? My friend applied for a stage crew job in this building. It wasn't this big then. It's a long, long time ago. And I said to the person that was in charge, are you hiring anyone else now? And got an interview right then and there. It's the only time I quit a job without notice because they were not so nice to me at the McDonald's, being sort of, I'm not saying this in a prejudicial way. I was a little overeducated and I talked about educated topics a little too much and I got some really bad jobs. One day someone ran over a duck in the drive-thru. You know, it's the McDonald's on Jog where Club Boca used to be. I'm really aging myself. And they said, will you clean it up? No, that's not in my contract. I wasn't going to do that. I'm a germphobe. You think I'm going to take a dead duck and put it into a garbage bag? Let somebody else do it. When I was younger, I would have freaked out, but I advocated. I should have said it more politely. That's another story. Will they accept authority? Your boss is your boss. You're going to, if it's reasonable, you need to do it. Will they ask for help if needed? That's one of the things. When someone's on the spectrum, they often freak out that I can't do this. What is someone going to say? You know what? There's things that other people can't do. How are you going to learn how to do it? By asking for help. Death and mourning. Well, I was debating whether or not to put this in. This is very important because I lost my grandfather my first year of college, and this was a very difficult thing. My father, who knew I had a fear of death, dealt with this in a very aspy way with me. He got me to choose the coffin for my grandfather's funeral because he felt that I needed to deal with it head on, which I would never do. That's one thing that I learned from my father that I would never, ever do. By not being able to express my feelings about my loss, I internalized them. And I perseverated. I ended up getting sick. I got mono and I was out of school for a month. When someone is dealing with this, you need to give them space if needed to absorb the situation because I never dealt with it directly. I had people in my family die that were not really in my life. They were peripheral characters. It was not someone that was in my life every day. Talk with them and encourage them to express their feelings when they are ready. Do not push, because they're going to go further, turn further in if you push them. Those who work with students with autism use social stories when they're ready to cope with their losses if needed. Social stories are like creating a scenario and letting them walk themselves through it to help them think about it and different strategies they could use to deal with the situation. For others, artistic outlets may be helpful for expression. College, independence, or bust, just the facts, Jack. Who did I steal that from? The older people will know this. They better know it. 1981 movie, Bill Murray. I'm giving you some clues. Stripes. Yes, I like that movie. Hopefully Bill won't come here and sue me. College, land of choices. College provides a great opportunity for individuals to focus on a field that's interest to them. But I tell you this, people that are parents and people on the spectrum, think about what you're going to do and do something marketable. Because for me, I did a BA in political science. Could anyone say gateway to graduate school? I loved it. I did very well at it. I had, not that I didn't want to continue my education, because I did, I had to continue. There are many opportunities to take part in many activities and expand their social life. You have a student union. You have a book with different clubs. There's something for everybody. And there, it's not like high school where you have these cliques. I made friends with people that I didn't think that I would be friends with. I made friends that were incidental. I met friends in class. I made friends through activities. And it was really good. And it's easier to find people like-minded interests, as I said, clubs and different happenings. People often grow more independent and become more mature. Have your kids do more for themselves. That my father was very hands-off. The only thing my father was hands-on when I did my bachelor's at FAU, because I came from Canada, someone in admissions said, oh, we would like him to go to Palm Beach College first. It was Palm Beach Community College at the time. I had a 3.3 at the time. My father wasn't having any of that. That's where the non-diplomacy worked well. He found someone in the Office of Admissions that became an ally, and I got in. When I graduated with a 3.81. It's you, if you want an opportunity, you have to fight for the opportunity. And it's a training ground for life college. There's more responsibility. There's things that you're going to learn to do and not do. Caution, caution, caution. Who did I steal that from? Think about a guy from Australia that had a nature show. Steve Irwin. Yes, I took that from him. In college, you make your own schedule and are responsible for it yourself. I took courses earlier in the day because I wanted to get them over with. I took courses at 8 in the morning that some people would look at me like I'm crazy. But it was good for me. Teachers will not remind you that assignments are due. It is your responsibility. If you live on campus, you'll need to take out time to do laundry and other tasks. I've seen people, when I've spoken to people from college with autism, out of sight, out of mind, and that's going to affect you socially and in other ways. That is not good. If you don't make the effort to socialize, you'll live in social isolation. I had some friends, but I was very quiet with people I didn't know. If my friend was going out with someone, my socialization, if you could call it that, was my books. Of course, my father would say, what do you think's going to happen? Ladies are going to line up at the door while you read your books on the Middle East. That was my strong interest then. From 15 to 38, I read 3,000 books on the Middle East. And hands-on parenting will not benefit someone with autism. It'll stunt their growth. They need to do for themselves. If they're not going to do it now, when they're adult, they're going to have one heck of a reckoning.
So what was your interest in the books?
Okay, because I liked the news from an early age. And at first, I had many different interests. At first, my youngest interest was flags when I was 7 years old. When I was 7 years old, I could identify every flag of the world. When I was 8 to 12, I was into World War II. I could tell you any battle, any figure that was involved. I would obsess about that, and I would have nightmares. My father decided the way to break me of that, because he was very worried about it, which I wouldn't have done it the way he did, but it needed to be done, was when I went to boarding school, he threw all my books away. It was harsh, but it was really giving me nightmares. It was really disrupting my life. In the Middle East, I've always found interesting. It's part of my background. I actually did a master's in Middle Eastern history. Yes, I'm a Reformed Lifer student. And I decided to go to the Middle East to do that. That's how strong my interest was. Go where it's happening.
What took you there? Like, what sparked that thing?
Because adventure, learning, knowledge. For me, knowledge is, I hope I don't offend anyone in here. I apologize if I do. I'm not a very religious person. To me, two things are important in life. Ethics, which goes along with treating people properly, and the pursuit of knowledge. And I felt when I decided to do a master's in Middle Eastern history, where would be better than the Middle East? I wanted to know it beyond the books. I wanted to go there. I've traveled in the Middle East. I've lived in the Middle East. That it's...
So you can learn more of the religious...
The religious aspect, the historical aspect, being there. I like the food, I like the people, I like the culture, going to different places. That I, to improve my Arabic, I went to Cairo for 2.5 months. That I enjoyed that. That's why when people say people with autism, we don't change, we won't take opportunities that were passive, it's not true. It's a matter of how you're raised, what you do with yourself, what motivation you have. Because there's plenty of people with autism that are incredibly talented people, incredibly driven people. That a lot of the things we have in the world, we wouldn't have if it wasn't for people with autism. And people often forget that. They stereotype it, even though I like Sheldon. Sheldon's a character on TV, Get a Life. I like him. It's a facsimile. It's not real life.
So how did you find that the people of the Middle East accepted you?
I didn't know at that time. I was diagnosed in my early 30s. I always knew there was a social component, but in certain parts of the Middle East, not having good eye contact was a good thing, because if you go to certain parts of the Middle East, if you have too intense eye contact, it's seen as a challenge.
As an insult. As well.
As an insult. And by being rule-oriented, the Middle East was very good for me. That when I was in Cairo, I respected the people. I realized that it was a more conservative place. I didn't walk around wearing shorts in Cairo because that was frowned upon. I wanted to learn about the people. I've been brought up in that way. That I to embrace your commonalities and embrace your differences, I want to learn what makes other people tick. I want to learn about the society. I want to learn about the foods. I want to learn about their history. I don't come like one of these stereotypical tourists with the camera taking shots everywhere. I went to places that tourists usually didn't go to. When I was in Turkey, I went to Konya, which is a town where the founder of Sufism for Turkey was born in the 1400s. And that's a very hard place to get to. I went to other places that I found out that the originator of pastrami wasn't from Romania like people think. It came from originally a dish which is like a smoked meat that was translucent, which came from Central Anatolian Peninsula. I went to that town just for that. So that's what happens when you're an autistic foodie. But that's me. I want to know that. I want to see these places. When my daughter's older, I want to take her to places. My daughter wanted to come to Denmark and Norway when I spoke there in November. I said, I don't think they're going to pick up the ticket. Don't do things just to seem cool. It's not worth it. You may embarrass yourself. This comes to drinking and things like this. I don't like the taste of alcohol. So you know what? Sometimes I would drink, most of the time I would have a soft drink or have a club soda, which people wouldn't know whether it was alcohol or not. Peer pressure continues in college. Don't do something because you feel you have to. And use caution if you're on the spectrum for considering joining a fraternity or sorority. I don't think they're bad things, but my experience was that it was a hyper-social situation. And there is pressure depending upon the fraternity or sorority. My experience was not great, but I don't think that's for everybody. I had friends in other fraternities, which hindsight I probably would have rushed instead, Rush means to try to join a fraternity. And don't expect others to advocate for you. When you're at FAU or any other college, they'll tell you the office with students with exceptionalities. You have to ask for the service yourself. Mommy and daddy are not going to do it for you. And this is important for life because you know, you need to do these things yourself. If I look for an apartment, am I going to take my father along? No. I did those things myself. Am I going to take my father along on a date? First of all, it'd be the first and only date. Even if they said okay, it would be how to alienate and anger people if you had them around. And it's a matter of making yourself more independent. And computers, this is where I get to. Computers are not a substitute for the real world. Computers and video games, because of their visual nature, are very attractive to us with autism. I love computers. But you know what? I have other responsibilities. My daughter's around and up. I try to stay off the computer unless she's watching one of her boring cupcake war shows. Because you know, it always comes out the same way, and you're going to see all the variations you can. But otherwise, I try to stay off when she's awake. It's an environment you can control, computer. Because for someone with autism, there's so much that we feel is beyond our control. Computers are not critical of us. They provide an opportunity for us to socialize on networks and games like World of Warcraft, and that's one of the reasons World of Warcraft is very pernicious. This isn't just for people with autism. There's many cases. There's a book that came out recently that I read in the past week speaking about internet and technological addiction. And it's something we really need to think about, not just for people with autism, but for everybody. And people with autism use computers to shut themselves off from the wider world. Computer games are addictive. It's fun. And they make it addictive. Temple Grandin wrote a book with a psychologist talking about this. They got people that use the psychology for casinos for video games to get people addicted. Because where the money is not subscribing to the video game, buying the additional lives, the additional weapons, the additional things. In the book that I read, even a woman who is a professional is talking about she got the app for Kim Kardashian's game and she went through $500 in 2 months. Think about this. We could laugh about this, but this was a professional. So if it could happen to her, it could happen to anybody. A helpful word of advice, before going to college, find out what services are offered to students with exceptionalities. Not all schools are created equal. You have a very good system here. You have the Office with Students with Disabilities and CARD here. It's really good. Not every school is like that. Go to the Office with Students with Disabilities and you have to ask for the service yourself if you're on the spectrum. Acquaint yourself with the layout of the campus where your courses take place. Some will say, oh, that's obvious. You know what? I thought that was obvious. Guess what happened my first week of school? Late all the time. Keep your schedule with you. I had 4 schedules in different places. I lost most of them, not all of them. Use a calendar on your phone to remind yourself of deadlines and important appointments. If you could afford so, get a tablet. A tablet works very well. It's useful for organization, and it's autistic friendly. I love my iPad, and I did not get paid by them. Consider going to college that has services and programs tailored towards people with autism. Not just FAU, but you have the CARD system at 7 different universities throughout the state. You also have Nova Southeastern has a new program that's not for many students yet that gives support. Outside of the state, you have the University of Alabama has a program. You have Boston University has a program. You have Marshall has a program where it's the oldest program in the country, and you have the West Virginia Autism Center that operates out of Marshall University, which is headed by Mark Ellison. I'm giving him a call out, a friend. And as I said, pick a major that is marketable. Just don't do something you like it. Do something that you could like and make a living doing. Unlikely savior and a realization. When I was in my second graduate degree, a professor in conversation thought I had autism as opposed to learning disabilities. What do you think I was thinking at that time? Who was I thinking when she said autism? Think of the 90s. Raymond from Rainman, okay? You know what? I know I'm a little nerdy. I don't have a pocket protector. I don't count perforations in the ceiling. I could tell you any baseball statistic you want or don't want to know, like the Menendez line. And I did not deal with it years because of that, because I said I wanted to be seen as normal. I was angry and in denial. I tried to ignore what was said. I said it could not be true. I spoke to family and friends. My mother, in fact, read an article and said, you're this, this, and this. I said to myself, I felt like an early bird menu of autistic pathology. I did not touch it for a long time because of that. I did not want it to be. And a lot of people, especially people that are diagnosed as adults or teenagers, feel this way. It's a process. Coming to terms with autism, I refused to accept not being normal. My father helped me with that one. He basically said normality is an overrated concept, along with other adjectives with that. While in session with a psychologist, I finally dealt with the issue over a period of months. I was diagnosed with autism. At least I had an answer that made sense. It made sense for the anxiety. It made sense for the perseveration. It made sense for the strong interest. It made sense for the nervousness. It made sense for not being able to express myself outward. Because how I would liken it, think about this way. Emotions for neurotypicals in here, that's what we call you. That's not without autism, is a raging river. For people with autism, emotions are the raging river, but it's covered by a thick sheet of opaque ice. Can I see the river if I have a 5-foot sheet of ice? Not really, huh? So my emotions are there, but they don't come to the surface. The only emotion that I've seen with most people with autism that they're efficient with is anger, and they have to be pushed to that. Because a lot of times, even when I'm angry, I won't show it. It may come 3 weeks later. It's a delayed reaction. And finally, I understood my anxiety, obsessing, social difficulties, and problems expressing self. Dress rehearsal, anyone. The art of the interview and securing employment. This is so important because you know what? You have to look at looking for a job in a realistic way, and there's steps to prepare, even for someone that's not on the spectrum. It's sort of an art that's sort of been lost with a lot of people. Apply for a job that's realistic and you can do. I had one student when I was doing an interest inventory said to me that he wanted to be a CIA agent. Okay, never mind that he could not shut up for a second. I don't think it would be a good career choice. Then he said a boxer. I said, you know, I'm not being mean, but I've met very few people with autism that are incredibly athletically inclined. It's few and far between. Can you say hazardous profession? My sarcasm came out. He didn't appreciate that. But I'm honest. I'm going to tell my students the way I see it. Role play in order to prepare for the interview. This means doing assimilation with someone that person could trust, like a family member or a friend. Working through what will be asked, how to answer the questions. When you get to the interview, dress nicely, wearing something appropriate for the interview. That means not wearing a Beavis and Butthead t-shirt with ripped jeans. Arrive early for the interview, 15 to 20 minutes early. My first teaching job, ironically, it wasn't my fault. I got stuck on the highway and I was late. I still got the job. But every other job, early. Use eye contact and be friendly. But there's a difference between using eye contact and staring at someone that makes you look like a serial killer. That's not good. When you're using eye contact, if you have trouble, this is for the people with autism, there's a way of doing it, pretending you have eye contact without having eye contact. Look at the bridge of someone's nose. They're not going to be able to tell the difference because of the field of vision for people. But you have to make it look that way and be friendly. Play up your accomplishments and show self-confidence. If you don't do that, you're not selling yourself, and why should they be interested in you? It's not bragging. Be to the point when answering questions. Don't talk too much. No one wants the history of the Western world. Stay on topic when replying to the question. Don't talk about everything but that. Talk about what's being asked and be to the point. Thank the interviewer for consideration when the interview is over. Call several days later, inquire whether a decision's been made. Why should I call? Why is it important? You're interested in, and to keep them in interest in you. Thank you. Awesome. Exactly. And that's what happens. My last job, to be very honest, I did not read it properly. It's my favorite job of my whole career, was Watson Duncan. I did not think I got the job. A half hour later, the phone rang, and they said, will you work with us? Yeah. To keep the job or not is the question. Arrive every day to your job early. I'm usually a half hour early so I could get situated. Do what you need to do. If you're not sure about something, ask for clarification. I wanted to be Superman when I was at one of my schools, and that created problems for me. Don't let anyone take advantage of you. When I worked at Coniston, I had this lovely person that got me to do all her IEPs for her, along with my own. After 2 years, I said, why am I doing her work? I have enough for myself. And I finally said no, I reached my limit. Don't let people take advantage of you. Be curious when dealing, be cautious, excuse me, when dealing with coworkers. Don't tell them about your whole life. It could create a huge amount of problems. People with autism think once they talk to people at times that they're their friend. They look at acquaintances as friends. You have to be very careful. I've had some problems in the past with that. In my school, no one knows anything about my wife. My wife might as well be Lilith from Frasier. Lilith was a character that you never saw on Frasier, which was the brother's wife. Try to read people's intentions. You need to know, looking at their face. One of the problems also with people on the spectrum is we tend not to look at the face when talking to people. We look at other parts of their body. There's a very good book called Contextual Blindness by Peter Vermeulen, who's a researcher out of Belgium that talks about it, why it's a problem and what you can do about it. Because there's other things we look at, and this is proven in study, many, many studies about it. And there's ways that you could train someone how to do it properly. When upset, don't lose your temper. There's only one time I really lost my temper, and I have to admit, I was happy I did. The same person that took advantage of me with the IEPs called me Miller. Always Miller. If I'm around the students, I want to be Mr. Miller. If I'm not around the students, John. Miller. I felt like a dog. I had enough of it one day and it just blew up. I wouldn't call it a mini meltdown. I wanted to. And what I did, it wasn't the greatest place to do it. I did it in the mail room down the hall from the principal's office. I was made to play nice with her, but guess what never happened again? never called me Miller. I stood up for myself. I dealt with it. But most of the time, you know what? I don't lose my temper. I had a child last year that screamed in my face for 20 minutes. And I smiled and told him, when you're ready to act like a young man, we could have a discussion. I thought about being on a beach with a nice book. I wasn't thinking about him screaming in my face. Don't tell people about your personal life. Extend yourself with people over time and be accessible. Because one of the things people think, because of our shyness, we're aloof when we're not. And when a woman is friendly and accessible, it does not necessarily mean she wants to go out with you. This is a very big problem with people with autism, of either sex, that they misread intentions. And someone could be smiling and it's just a friendly smile and that's it. And that could create very bad situations. If a fellow worker is pressuring or bullying you, you go to human resources. I'm going to be very honest. At my last school, I had people trying to undermine me. I had discrimination against myself. I had someone telling me to quit acting so autistic. I brought it to my principal, and my principal said, oh, she's joking. If it was about someone's gender orientation, about someone that was of a minority background or someone of another exceptionality that was more visible, they would be taking it more seriously. What happened to me after my second year at that school, I was put in a room that they hoped I would quit. Parents asked, why wasn't I teaching their kids anymore at that school? And the person that was the primary person responsible said, oh, it wasn't my decision. I didn't give up. One of the most beautiful qualities about people with autism is we're obstinate. We don't give up. We're not going to walk away from something, especially when it's an injustice. I spent my year in there. It was beyond voluntary transfer. I said to my principal, you know what happened to me this year. If I get a job elsewhere, let me go. I do not want to be here. I got a job elsewhere. I went out of my way to get a job elsewhere. And I did that. I was not going to be put in a situation that was making me unhappy. I advocated for myself, and I did what I needed to do for myself. If I'm going to teach my students to stand up for themselves, I need to stand up for myself. If there's an issue at work, you need to speak about it in an appropriate manner. Do not wish it away. What do people with autism bring to the table for a job? Honesty, drive, ability to focus on a subject for a mind-boggling period of time, persistence, a strong desire to succeed. We think outside the box. We're going to see things a lot differently than you will, and we may see something that you didn't see. And very strong interest. Some people call it obsessiveness. I don't like that. Something's obsessive only if it disrupts your life. Otherwise, it isn't. Because if someone's neurotypical and they're like Elon Musk, you're not going to call them obsessed about technology. You're going to admire them. So don't have a double standard with us.